The Indian economy, the seventh largest economy in the world, the third largest by purchasing power. The Indian economy has an underground economy. The scriptures of last 5,000 years, which include the Vedas, Ramayana, and Mahabharata, cultivated many values and virtues amongst us. No wonder it was described as Ram Rajya. However, since independence, in last 70 years, it looks like that we've forgotten most of them. Have we become more selfish, greedy, and self-centered? Are we thinking of ourselves first, then our family, community, and last about our nation? One has to think seriously.
Did we change for the worse due to environments and systems that were created around us? Was it because of the growing population, illiteracy, poverty, shortage economy, and notably the license and inspector Raj? The power was concentrated in the hands of bureaucracy and the polity. Unfortunately, some of them did not pursue the ethics which were expected from them. They started exploiting the situation and amassed considerable wealth which was disproportionate to the income which they had. Some of them transferred these funds to overseas countries. This deprived the country of the funds.
Corruption is becoming a way of life in India in every sphere. One cannot put it under the carpet. It must be discussed openly, and remedial measures should be developed to curb it. The Indians holding the largest amount in foreign banks in 80 countries, estimated at $1,500 billion, is obviously the ill-gotten wealth of the industrialists, bureaucrats, and politicians. The biannual report published by Transparency International on corruption levels in different countries shows India ranks very high as a corrupt nation at 76 out of 160 countries.
We have nurtured a parallel economy in the country. This is also termed as underground economy or the black economy. It has been estimated to be around 15 trillion rupees, close to 40% of our gross domestic product or GDP. No income tax is paid on this black money, thereby depriving the nation of welfare funds. This black money is generated by some undeserving rich Indians, which may include the film stars, cricketers, jewelers, builders, and of course, the bureaucrats and the politicians. This black money is not only generated in the country, but also abroad. Some people feel that this black money is kept in cash. As per the estimate, only 6% of this money is kept in cash, and the other is invested in Benami transactions in land, building, jewelry, precious stones, and of course, in foreign currencies. We have been talking so far on the black money and the black economy. It leads to the generic term corruption. What is this corruption? It can be seen that each word has many dictionary meanings. With reference to context, we will have to apply a particular meaning to a situation. I am proposing that corruption can take four forms. The first one is obviously monetary corruption. Kautilya, 2500 years back, had said that corruption is mostly monetary. But lately, it is taking different forms in terms of bribes, kickbacks, embezzlement, patronage, and nepotism. Indians keep on discovering new facets of monetary corruption every day. The second is moral corruption. It is not necessary that money should always be involved in unethical practices. Every common man has certain expectations on ethics. When these ethics are broken, it results in moral corruption. We believe that fields like education, judiciary, social work, and religion should be above corruption. When that does not happen, it disturbs us in the form of moral corruption. The third area is the intellectual corruption. Indians are notorious when it comes to intellectual corruption. It comes in the form of piracy. This could be in the areas of computer software, books, audio, video cassettes, and any breakdown in areas of intellectual property rights, commonly called as IPR. In the last few years, Mafia Raj has entered in many fields. This includes the land mafia, water mafia, adulterated and fake goods mafia, counterfeit notes and stamp paper mafia, and many others. I am pained to make this observation that Indians show substantial innovation in these areas. This involves organized crime, having nexus with the polity and bureaucracy. Many people have lost their lives fighting with this mafia.
What are the factors which give rise to corruption? Large population, poverty, low levels of education, lack of clean leaders and role models, no social stigma attached to corrupt persons. Even though we have several laws to curb corruption, they lack teeth. The law is slack, slow, and mostly corrupt itself. The nexus between politicians, bureaucrats, and the businessmen is difficult to break. The underworld has entered in every sphere and is using its money power as well as muscle power to get things done their way.
In a population of close to 125 crores, it is very difficult to accurately have the measure of corrupt people in India. The message painted at the back of a truck perhaps reflects the sentiments of people. Jab 95% Bharatiya hai beiman, aap kaise keh sakte hai mera Bharat mahan? Perhaps 95% could be an exaggeration. It will be therefore the perception one would like to have for measuring the corrupt people in India. I hope I am proved wrong. But in my opinion, 40% Indians are indulging in corrupt practices. These people could be in any demographics. They could be in any age group, gender, educational level, income groups, as well as religions. Many people could be extremely pious, God-fearing, but even then, when they are confronted with the opportunities, they grab them with both their hands and indulge in corrupt practices. greed is the major driver in corruption. These are the people, they feel that they will never be caught, and even if they are caught, they feel that Indian laws are so lax that they will never be convicted.
A common man most naively believes that politics is the main fountain of corruption. This is only partially true. It is sad, but a fact, that corruption has entered almost every sector of our society, which includes industry and business, politics, bureaucracy, judiciary, media, education, healthcare, defense, sports.
Corruption is an intractable problem. It is like diabetes. It can be controlled, but it cannot be cured completely. If in our country, we can come out with some control and reduce the corruption to some extent, I think we would be achieving a great. This will require dedicated people, honest people in different walks of life. Control over electoral expenses. And most importantly, speedy justice and strong laws to control this corruption. Recently, the government took a major step in this direction by demonetizing ₹500 and ₹1,000 currency notes. It was believed that 86% of the money which is circulated is in these two currency notes. By this, the government is trying to curb the use of and generation of black money. Government is trying to encourage the electronic transfer of money by using credit cards, net banking, and maybe other means. If this can be achieved, it will have a curb on black money use in the country.
And we all can walk further on the same way. Let's gather the courage to confront the facts, expose the corruption, ensure that there is prima facie evidence of unethical practice at any level. Discuss with few like-minded persons about the same. Try to find out the appropriate authority to whom you can complain. It could be Anti-Corruption Bureau or a higher authority in that organization.
So far, we believed in innocent till proven guilty. The time has come now to change it to guilty till proven innocent. The cycle time for legal action will have to be reduced to, say, 3 months if we want to have some action against corruption. For this purpose, fast-track courts will have to be set up. Let's take a vow that we'll neither take bribe nor give bribe. And let us spread the message to one and all. The book Corruption Indian Style gives more than 100 options to curb corruption considering the psyche of Indians. Exemplary punishments will have to be given to the guilty people. The virtues of honesty and integrity must be taught from every forum.
Let it not be said by a future forlorn generation that our despair was so deep that we did not even try, or we always thought that somebody else will come forward to fight our battles. Ralph Nader.